الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're going to, inshallah ta'ala, take the biography of Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i rahimahullah, Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i. And we're also going to speak about his Sunan. What is Sunan Nasa'i? Have an understanding of it, inshallah ta'ala. And next week, we will talk about Sunan Ibn Majah. And then we have an exam after that, inshallah ta'ala. And once we finish Sunan Ibn Majah, we would have finished bi-idhnillahi al-kareem all of the what? All of the 6 books of Sunnah. You have an understanding of it. You then should try to go and read more into it. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, his kunya is Abu AbdulRahman. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, his kunya. Do you know what a kunya is? Is when you're attributed to a child. See what I said? It's when you're attributed to a child. It doesn't have to necessarily be what? It may not even be your child. You may not even have ever got married in your life. Our mother Aisha was called Umm al-Mu'mineena. She was called Umm Abdillahi. She was called what? She was called Umm Abdillahi. But she never was with children. Rather, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave the kunya to a young kid, a young child. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam call him? What did he call him? Aba Numair, he said, ma fa'ala Nughair. لذلك الإمام البخاري, chapter about the permissibility of giving a kunya to a child, a little kid. It was the Arabs' culture to give a kunya to the person. Even if you don't have a child, just have a kunya. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, his kunya is Abu Abdirrahman. His name is, that's his kunya. His actual name is Ahmed. His name is Ahmed ibn Shu'aib ibn Ali ibn Sufyan ibn Bahr ibn Dinar al-Khurasani al-Nasa'i. So all you need to know is his kunya is Abu Abdirrahman. His kunya is Abu Abdirrahman, and his name is Ahmed, and his father's name is Shu'aib. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i was born fi Madinati Nasa. Fi Madinati Nasa. He was born in a Medina called Nasa. We will touch on this place called Nasa. Why was it given this name? Where is it currently? We'll speak about that. Lakin, he was born in that Medina, Medina to Nasa. And he was born when the year was 215. عام خمسة عشرة ومئتين. 215 is when he was born. And this is the view of the A'immah. From them, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah and Al-Imam al-Sakhawi. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi and Al-Imam al-Sakhawi both believed that this was when he was born. Rather, it's transmitted from him himself that this is when he was born. But when he did transmit it that this was when he was born, he didn't make it with what? Certainty. He didn't say, this is exactly when I was born. But he said, roughly. I said something important last lesson, or I don't know if it was a lesson before that, I mentioned that these individuals were not known when they were first born. وَهَذِهِ عَادَ مَعْرُوفَ. If you're nothing, no one would want to know when you were born. But when you're dying, and when you die, it becomes what? A significant day in the calendar. Are we all together, brothers? And that is an indication to show that when you come into this world, you haven't come with anything yet. But when you leave, your coming to this world should not be waste of time and space and oxygen. And all you've come with in this world is you've left your dead corpse and your feces. And you've not brought any khair or good to this world. In whatever majal, whatever field it may be, some people may even bring a worldly benefit to the Muslims. That's khair in its way as well. But to be somebody who brings khair and good. So this is the strongest opinion, is that he was born this 215. Where did we say he was born in? Madinatu Nasa. This Madinatu Nasa is in Akhir Khurasan. It's at the ending of Khurasan. Okay? And it's on the northwest of Khurasan. So if you get the old map, it's on the northwest of Khurasan, which is very close to Ash-Shimaliyyah Al-Gharbiyyah, northwest, which is very close to Khawarizma, which currently today it's in Turkmenistan. Turkmenistan, that's where it is. Currently that's where it falls in. It's very close to the capital of Turkmenistan, about approximately 5 miles. Why is it given this name, this place? Why is it called Nasa? Why is it called An-Nasa'iyu? We know that the word An-Nasa'iyu, it means female, Nisa, woman. What's the significance of this name? Where did it come from? First of all, there's two dabt, there's two ways of saying it. The first one is, the one that we all know, is saying An-Nasa'iyu. That's one way of saying it. There's another way of saying it, which is An-Nasawiyu. An-Nasawiyu. The first one is the most common, which is An-Nasa'iyu. That's the most common. And the second one was mentioned by Sam'ani in his Kitab Al-Ansab. An-Nasawiyu. An-Nasawiyu. He said, why was this balad, why was it called this name, An-Nasa'iyu ama An-Nasawi? Why was it called An-Nasa? Al-Imam al-Sam'aniyu, he said, the reason why it was called this name is, fi ibtida'i al-Islami, in the early beginning of al-Islam, when the Muslims wanted to conquer An-Nasa, Islam was spreading, it was taking over lands. When it came to this place and they wanted to open it, they found that the men were absent. The men were not there. And the women were there, and the women were fighting. The women were trying to fight. And in our religion, we're not allowed to fight with what? We're not allowed to fight with the women. So the Muslims, they withheld. They withheld from what? Anil harbi, fighting. Because لِأَنَّ النِّسَاءَ لَا يُحَارَبْنَا. The women are not fought. Women are not fought. So they delayed from fighting. That's one view. Another view that it mentions, إِنَّمَا سُمِّيَتْ. The reason why it was called Nasa is because the men never used to fight at all. The men were not strong. And who was strong? Their women were fighters. Their women were warriors. They used to fight. And so this is why it was called An-Nasa. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he spent the second portion of his life in Egypt. I will speak about that in more details. He left it and he went to Palestine. We'll see why he did that, rahimahullah. And he died in Palestine in Ramallah. He died in where? Palestine, Ramallah. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. Let's talk a bit about Al-Imam al-Nasa'i's personality, how he looked, what type of person he was. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, as I mentioned, he grew up a nasha'ah ilmiyah. He's growing up, he's nurturing, his father nurtured him upon knowledge. Ilm, the importance of knowledge. His father and his family members, they pushed in his heart this. وَطَلَبَ الْعِلْمَ فِي صِغَرِهِ. And he sought knowledge at a very young age. And he took the basic and the foundation of knowledge. And this is something very important, which is a student of knowledge should not at the beginning restrict himself to a particular science. Don't do that to yourself. If you want to learn the religion, open your heart and mind to what? All of the science. And don't restrict yourself to what? Don't restrict yourself to one science. That can be something you could do later, maybe. Later in your life, you can specialize in one of the fields. But first of all, put your leg into grammar, study that. Go to fiqh, study it. Go to usul al-fiqh, study it. Go to ulum al-Quran and tajweed and qira'at, look into it. Go to all of the sciences, and of course, in your heart, there's going to be one science. Allah gives you love towards it, and you're more passionate about that science, then you can specialize in that science. ولذلك the poet, he said, من كل فن خذ ولا تجهل به فالحر مطلع على الأسرار. All science, all of knowledge, take from it. So this is what he did. By the time he was 15, brothers, 15, 15 years of age. What are our 15-year-olds doing? Playing games, huh? They know the different players and they're on the playing games. That's, look how Imam al-Nasa'i at his time, the type of people they were. 15, he was ready to travel. Travel in what? He took the basics that were needed. He knew the Quran, he knew Arabic, he knew this, he knew that. He was ready. He was prepared to go and leave his household and travel the world and to get knowledge. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. And so he did. He traveled to seek knowledge. And traveling to seek knowledge is after you mastered the book of Allah. Hifz, itqan. You know it like the back of your hand, as we say, huh? You know it very well. And also, you can't travel because the other a'imma will not take you serious if you haven't memorized the Quran, if you haven't at least, huh? You have knowledge of other things. That's only when you... So it shows you when he was 15, he was ready to travel. It also shows you the maturity and the mindset of Al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah ta'ala. And that he also grasped ulum al-ala, the instrumental knowledge. That's what it shows you. In terms of his personality and his characteristics, an Imam al-Nasa'i is not your ordinary Imam. What do I mean by that? An Imam al-Nasa'i, in terms of life, he lived a lavish life. An Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah ta'ala. He wasn't a person who you would consider or you would add to those who are fuqara, poor. No. He really took care of his what? His malbas, his clothing. He would wear very beautiful clothes. Rahimahullah. Sometimes he would wear green, and he would say the reason is because the greenery, what does it do for your eyes? It's good for your eyes, right? And so he would say, this is a rahimahullah ta'ala. He would also eat regularly meat. This was not common amongst the a'imma. Some of them would not get meat for months, but he had meat daily, rahimahullah ta'ala. And that meat had to be cooked in a specific way for him, rahimahullah ta'ala. One of the things that were mentioned about his life, rahimahullah ta'ala, is وكان يكثر الجماع مع صوم يوم وإفطار الصوم. He was married to four wives. الإمام النسائي was what? Was married to what? Four wives. And in that department, the scholars, they said, وَكَانَ يُكْثِرُ الْجِمَعَ. It was a lot. With the rights of his wife at night, Imam al-Nasa'i, they said he was a lot. Rather, with four wives, he also had slaves. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And some of the historians, they mentioned, he used to say, this is all from what I eat healthy. Al-Imamu al-Nasa'i, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ. With that, كَانَ يَصُومُ يَوْمًا وَيُفْطِرُ يَوْمًا. He would fast one day, and he wouldn't fast the next day. So he used to do the fasting of Nabilah Hud with that. But when the iftar time was ready, the meat has to be ready. It would be cooked for him. And they used to say that he would be given a big slice of meat, rahimahullah ta'ala, that was cooked in a way he liked it. With that said, he was an individual who stayed away from anything that was doubtful. He was a person who was what? Who stayed away from what was doubtful. ولذلك some of the scholars they mentioned, he used to sit in the halaqa of Ahmed ibn Salih al-Misri, who we're going to speak about later. They mentioned that he used to sit in the halaqa of Ahmed ibn Salih al-Misri. And he used to dress very good. And he got kicked out of the halaqa because of that. He would dress, wear his clothes very well. And he would sit in the halaqa and stick up from the rest of the people. ولذلك even his height was very long, strong and tall, rahimahullah ta'ala. He had haybah. People would respect him when they saw him. He was qawiyul jisma, very strong person. His face would glow even though his beard became white. Because he was the last one to die from the six scholars, right? From the six scholars, he was the last of them to die. He died 88 years of age. Ma'adhalik, his face was young. His face was young, rahimahullah ta'ala. He was a person who turned towards Allah Azza wa Jalla wal iqbalu ala Allah ta'ala, rahimahullah ta'ala. They mentioned, as Muhammad ibn al-Mudaffar, he said, Sami'tu, I heard mashayikhana, our teachers, بمصر in Egypt, يصفون اجتهاد النسائي. They would describe Al-Imam al-Nasa'i striving في العبادة بالليل والدهار. How his ibadah was at night, he prayed قيام الليل, a lot. رحمه الله تعالى. رحمة واسعة. There's an event that we need to mention regarding Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, which is that he, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, had to leave Egypt. Remember I said the second half of his life, he spent it in where? Egypt. He spent it in Egypt. But there was something that forced Al-Imam al-Nasa'i to leave Egypt. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, 3 months before his death, before he died, three months and a half before he died, he left Egypt. He left Egypt. And his student, Ibn Yunus, spoke about it. But the scholars, they differed. What was the reason why he left Egypt? What caused his leaving of Egypt? What made him leave Egypt? And they also differed on, when he left Egypt, where did he go? So they differed on what? His leaving of Egypt, and they also differed on his, where he headed, and where he went to when he left Egypt. Let's look at what his student said, Abu Sa'id ibn Yunus, and Al-Imam al-Darqutni. As Al-Imam al-Hakim mentioned, that these two scholars, Abu Sa'id ibn Yunus and Al-Imam al-Darqutni, both of them mentioned, and the person who transmitted these two scholars' statement is Abu Abdullah al-Hakim al-Nisaburi, that they too said, the reason why he left Egypt was, أَنَّهُ لَمَّا بَلَغَ, when he reached مِنَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْمَكَانَةِ, he reached a level in knowledge. He started to gain a position in knowledge. And he's a man of great knowledge. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i حَسَدَهُ النَّاسُ. Jealousy entered the people's hearts towards him. What happened? He's a man of ilm, man of makana, position. And this went into what? It went into the heart of the scholars of Egypt with him. Not to mention, he wasn't actually an Egyptian. So he's in a country, he's a foreigner, number one. And then he's highly respected. So what did this cause? He's a minority. And the majority, the people of the land. And you've come here, and you're what? So this causes and places in the heart of the people what? Hasad. What does it put in the heart of people? And this is common. If you read the biography of some of the ulama, you find that this is common. This is common. وَلِذَلِكَ إِبْنُ حَجَرْ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. He mentioned this from who? Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhali towards Imam al-Bukhari. Ibn Hajar mentions this in his kitab Hidayatu al-Sari fi tarjamat al-Imam al-Bukhari, that Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhali, when Imam al-Bukhari came to Khurasan or Naysabur, when he came to Naysabur, he gave who Imam al-Bukhari what? A big problem that made or was the cause of Imam Bukhari wanting to leave Naysabur and wanting to die because the people went against him. And Bukhari, when he came into Naysabur, the people of Naysabur were coming from every corner. He couldn't enter the city. And when he left by himself. Or he left with a handful of people. Hasad. The same is if you look at Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, who was a great grammarian, who was a student of Imam Malik. Student of Ibn Malik rahimahullah, Jamaluddin Ibn Malik. He was a student of who? Jamaluddin Ibn Malik, Abu Abdullah Jamaluddin Ibn Malik, the author of the Alfiyah, Alfiyah Ibn Malik. He was his student. And so in his heart, something went in towards Ibn Malik. And then he criticized a book which the Ummah have agreed upon its greatness. Which book? Alfiyah Ibn Malik. The scholars they praise this book. Even he said about his book, he said, فَائِقَةً أَلْفِيَّةَ ابْنَ مُعْطِي وَهُوَ بِسَبْقٍ حَائِزٌ تَفْضِيلًا مُسْتَوْجِمٌ ثَنَائِيَ الْجَمِيلًا وَاللَّهُ يَقْضِي بِهِبَاتٍ وَافِرًا لِوَلَهُ فِي دَرَجَاتِ الْآخِرَةِ. That my Alfiyah is better than all of the previous Alfiyat. He came and what did he do? He criticized it. So this is common, we see that a lot. This will happen. But one thing I do want to say is, for you to think that people have jealousy to you, is not a good trait. Let me repeat that. For you to think that people have jealousy towards you is not a good thing. Why? Because it's a fara. It implies that you're saying that you have something for people to have jealousy of. And the characteristics of the noble person is he doesn't see that of himself. He doesn't see what or why people will be jealous of him. Are we all together? So he doesn't see why a person will be jealous of him. So he doesn't give. And that's a good characteristic. But if you think everybody's jealous of you, then that means you kind of believe in your heart, I'm righteous, I'm good, or I'm this, I'm that, and people are just jealous at me every time. And also the reason why it's not good to think that people are jealous of you all the time is you won't take the constructive criticism that people bring. Sometimes people will bring what? They will bring good criticism, constructive, beneficial for you. And so what happens? You dismiss it on the grounds of what? Everyone's jealous. The reason why he's critical is because he's jealous. Are we all together, brothers? So it's not good to think that way. You get that rid out of, get that rid of your heart. Anyways, Imam al-Nisa'i rahimahullah ta'ala, that was the first reason some of the scholars mentioned why he left Egypt. The second reason is because he wanted to go Hajj. And both of those reasons were present. Meaning he felt jealousy. It was made in Egypt and it caused him problems. So he left. And when he left, he went to Makkah for Hajj. He went to where? Makkah for Hajj. Those do not contradict one another. Other scholars, they mention Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, when he came to the place of death after he did his Hajj, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i came to Ramallah. Where did he come to? Ramallah in Palestine. Some scholars, they mention, no, he didn't die in Ramallah, he died in what? Bain al-Safa wal-Marwa, in Mecca. Between Safa and Marwa, he's buried there. Some people said that. And some scholars, they said, no, that's not true. He died in Ramallah, in Palestine. He died in Ramallah. And this seems to be stronger because the person who said that he died in Ramallah is his student. And Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said, هَذَا أَصَحُ فَإِنَّ ابْنَ يُونَسَ. Because Ibn Yunus, Abu Sa'id Ibn Yunus, is the student of Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. He said, فَإِنَّ ابْنَ يُونَسَ حَافِظٌ يَقِضٌ. Ibn Yunus is a person who is alert, he's sharp-minded individual. وَقَدْ أَخَذَ عَنِ النَّسَائِي وَهُوَ بِهِ عَارِفٌ. And he took from Nasa'i, so he knows it better. He knows where his teacher died. But when he came to Ramallah, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah ta'ala, a problem happened to him, a fitna. This fitna that happened to Al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah, it led to him getting beaten. It led to him getting beaten, rahimahullah ta'ala. This is what some scholars, they mentioned. So he got beaten in Ramallah, and they said that this is where he went to Mecca, and that's why he died in Mecca. Those who are saying he died in Mecca. And others are saying, no, he didn't die in Mecca. The mihna happened to him in Ramallah, and he died in Ramallah. But he got beaten so badly, rahimahullah ta'ala, he became ill, and he died from it. He died from that beating. And the ones who beat him were the Khawarij. They beat him. And Imam al-Nasa'i, he was the last one from the six to die. And the six of the scholars are on the level of his teachers. The other five, they were on what level? مرتبة شيوخه. They're on the level of his teachers. As Al-Imam al-Sakhawi mentions in his kitab Al-Qawl al-Mu'tabir. And the scholars, they add him to the list of the mu'ammarin, those who aged. He didn't die yet, very young. How old was he when he died? 88, that's a very old age. Anything, by the way, that's above 70 is, mashallah, it's an old age. Because the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? أعمار أمتي ما بين 60 و 70 وقليل من يجوز ذلك. The Prophet said that my ummah will live between what, 60 and little go over 70. If you go over 70, you're from the little, from the few. The overwhelming majority of the people are going to die before 70. So you're going to disobey Allah for 70 years if you live? For a hellfire, Allahu A'lam, how long is it going to take you? Rahmatullahi alayhi, may Allah have mercy on him. Wa askanahu fasiha jannati. May Allah place him in Jannah. We're now going to go into some of the teachers of Al-Imam al-Nasa'i and some of his students. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, his teachers, the senior teachers that he took from, the most famous teachers that he took from, we're going to mention them inshallah ta'ala. The first one is Qutaybah ibn Sa'id al-Baghlani. Qutaybah ibn Sa'id al-Baghlani rahimahullah, who died a year 240 Hijriya. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i took from him. And he is the one that Al-Imam al-Nasa'i narrated the most from in his Sunan. He narrated from him in his Sunan 677 times. Qutaybah ibn Sa'id. And he narrated from him when he was about 15, 16, very young. Also, Amr ibn Ali ibn Bahr al-Fallas al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala. He also took from Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. Who knows when al-Imam al-Bukhari died? Al-Imam al-Bukhari died when? 256. He also took from Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Dhuhali Muhammad ibn Yahya al-Duhali, he took from him. And he died in the year 258 Hijriah. He also took from Abu Zur'at al-Razi. Abu Zur'at al-Razi died 264. He also took from Abu Dawood al-Sijistani, who died in the year 275. He also took from Abu Hatim al-Razi, who died in the year 277. These are the abrazu shuyukhi, and these are the kibaru shuyukhi, his senior teachers. You can always go back to the recording. I'm going to quickly mention those teachers and how many times he narrated from them. I'm going to mention 15 of them. The 15 most common narrators in which he narrated from. The first one is Qutaybah ibn Sa'id. He narrated from him 677. Ishaq ibn Ibrahim ibn Makhlad al-Hanbali, Ishaq ibn Rahuya is known as, who is a thiqatun hafidul mujtahid. Ishaq ibn Rahuya, he narrated from him 344 times. Amr ibn Ali ibn Bahrin, al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah, he narrated from him 208 times. Suwayd ibn Nasr ibn Suwayd al-Maruzi is a thiqah, he narrated from him 208 times. Muhammad ibn al-Muthanna, Abu Musa al-Zaman, he's a thiqatun thabt, he narrated from him 193. Muhammad ibn Bashar al-Abdari, al-Abdi, al-Bundar, Muhammad ibn Bashar al-Bundar, who's a thiqah, he narrated from him, Muhammad ibn Bashar, how many times did he narrate from him? He narrated from him 186 times. Muhammad ibn Abdul A'la al-San'ani al-Basri, 159. Ismail ibn Mas'ud, Abu Mas'ud al-Dimashqi, 147. Al-Harith ibn Miskin, 144. Ali ibn Hajar, 137. Ya'qub ibn Ibrahim al-Zuhriyu, 115. Muhammad ibn Salamata, he narrated from 109. Muhammad ibn Mansur ibn Dawood, 108. Ubaidullah ibn Sa'id al-Yashkuri al-Saraqsi, Nazilus Naysabur, he narrated from him 108. And Ahmad ibn Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, he narrated from 104. Those are the most common shuyukh that he has, his students. His students, Abu Bishr al-Dulabi. Abu Bishr al-Dulabi is the student and a peer, like a friend of Imam al-Nasa'i. So this was called Aqran, but he narrated from him as well. Abu Awana al-Isfra'ini. Abu Awana al-Isfra'ini, who has the mustakhraj. He also narrated from him. Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, the author of Aqidat al-Tahawiyah. The author of Aqidat al-Tahawi was a student of Imam Nasa'i. From his students is Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli, the author of Al-Du'afa. Abu Ja'far al-Nahas al-Nahwi, Ibn al-A'rabi, Abu Sa'id al-A'rabi was his student. From his student is Ibn Hibban, Abu Hatim al-Busti, the author of the Sahih Ibn Hibban, is his student. Abu al-Qasim al-Tabarani, who authored the Mu'jam, the Ma'ajim al-Thalatha, Mu'jam al-Kubra, and Mu'jam al-Kabir, Saghir and al-Wusta. Also from his students is Abu Bakr ibn al-Sunni. This one you have to write because we need him. Abu Bakr ibn al-Sunni. This one is one of his students. Abu Bakr ibn al-Sunni rahimahullah. And a lot of the times, you can actually tell from a person's what? His greatness and how high he is, his students. What kind of students he has. To have these type of people, his students, is big, right? Because these are big scholars themselves. Now we're going to go into his sunan. We're going to now go into the sunan. This kitab, as-sunan, what's the name of the book? There's three common names that is given to. Sunan Nasa'i, the three common names. There are three what? Common names. The first one is Al-Mujtaba. What is it called? Al-Mujtaba. What is it? Al-Mujtaba. Al-Mujtaba. And Al-Mujtaba, as you can see from the name, is Istifa and Ittiqa. Is Istifa and Intiqa, right? It's to select. The word Mujtaba means what? It's to what? It is to select something. Allah said in the Quran, فَاجْتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ. His Lord chose him. So the word Al-Mujtaba, what does it mean? It's to select something from somewhere. We'll see where, what's the selection, where was it taken from? We'll mention that later. But that's what it means. Who gave it this name, Al-Mujtaba? Are we all together? Who gave it this name? There is a Somali doctor, Somali. His name is called Umar Iman Abu Bakr. He has a book where he called it Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i. Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i wa Kitabu Al-Mujtaba. Kitabatu Al-Ma'arif published it. Are we all together, brothers? So he talks about the Kitab Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i. He said that this name is from the author himself. He's the one who came with this name. And he used as a proof to argue his point that he said, if you go to the book in within the Sunan, Al-Mujtaba, okay, if you go to the Mujtaba, within it, there is a kitab called Kitab Al-Qasama. Kitabu Al-Qasama. If you go within there, you find a chaptering where it says, بَابُ مَا جَاءَ فِي كِتَابِ الْقِصَاصِ مِنَ الْمُجْتَبَى. From the Mujtaba. So within the book, the author calls it from the Mujtaba. And the content in the book is the author's content. So he used the word what? Mujtaba. So the name came from who? Al-Imam Nasa'i himself. But this kid be argued back to the doctor on the grounds and the basis of what? First of all, the nusakhs and the copies of Sunan Nasa'i are different. And is this present in all the riwayat that are narrated from Imam Nasa'i, or is this from the riwayah that a particular student has in his copy? That needs verification. That's another mas'ala. Number two, the second name that is given is As-Sunan al-Sughra. As-Sunan al-Sughra. As-Sunan al-Sughra. That's one of the names it's given. The scholars that gave it that name is Al-Imam al-Suyuti and Ibn Imad. Al-Suyuti, Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, he called it Sunan al-Sughra. And Al-Imam al-Suyuti, Al-Imam al-Imad, he also called it Sunan al-Sughra. The third name that it's given is Sunan al-Nasa'i. Sunan al-Nasa'i. The Sunan of Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. That's the third name it's given. And that third name is what's on the copies that are published now. Like the overwhelming majority of the books, you'll find Sunan al-Nasa'i, Sunan al-Nasa'i, Sunan al-Nasa'i. Even the Tab'a of Dar al-Ta'seel and others, they mention Sunan al-Nasa'i. Are we all together? Some of the scholars, they called Sunan al-Nasa'i, they called it As-Sahih. Call As-Sahih. They called it what? From them who called it As-Sahih is Ibn Manda. Ibn Manda, he called it Sahih. Ibn Sakan, he called it As-Sahih. Abu Ali al-Naysaburi, he called it As-Sahih. Ad-Daraqutni, he called it As-Sahih. Ibn Adi, he called it al-Sahih. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, he called it al-Sahih. And al-Imam al-Zahabi called it al-Sahih. And that's not correct. وَمَنْ عَلَيْهَا أَطْلَقَ الصَّحِيحَ فَقَدْ أَتَى تَسَاهُلًا سَرِيحًا وَمَنْ عَلَيْهَا أَطْلَقَ الصَّحِيحَ فَقَدْ أَتَى تَسَاهُلًا صَرِيحًا. Anyone who calls other Bukhari and Muslim Sahih, and of course Ibn Hibban's kitab, and al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah's kitab, anyone other than those books who try to call it al-Sahih, فَقَدْ أَتَى تَسَاهُلًا صَرِيحًا, has come with so much leniency. Like, Hassan is not precise in what they are saying. Okay? So there's no, it's not accepted. Jesus call it what? Sahih. Here is another question. When the name Sunan is used, what is referred to it? When we say Sunan Nasa'i, why would we ask this question? Why would we ask this question? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i has two sunan. How many sunan does he have? He has two sunan. Al-Imam al-Nasa'i has what? Two sunan. He has a big one and he has a small one. Are we all together, brothers? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, how many sunan does he have? Two. Are we all together, brothers? And he has a small one. Big one and a small one. So when you say Sunanun Nasa'i, does it go to the big one or does it go to small one? This is the question. If you just say that, Sunan Nasa'i, does it go to the small one directly? Does it go to the big one? This is a dispute amongst the scholars. This is a dispute amongst the scholars. Some of the scholars, they said that it's meant by the big one. Some of the scholars, they said that. Like the Indian scholar, Abdul Shams, Al-Abadi, rahimahullah ta'ala, the author, the explainer of Sunan Abi Dawud, Unul Ma'bud. Abdul Azim Al-Abadi, Shamsul Haq, Abdul Azim Al-Abadi. He mentions that it's referring to the big one. That's the view he took. The Somali Sheikh, the Somali doctor, what did he take? He took that it's also the big one. The second view is, it means the small one. And the scholars that push that view is Tajuddin al-Subki, Suyuti, Abu Tlib, Siddiq Hassan Khan, and Muhammad al-Kattani, and also Ibn Asir al-Jazari. It's kind in his Jam' al-Usul, it's like he leans towards that opinion as well. He leans to that opinion as well. Why? Because when he says Sunan Nasa'i, he only brought the Mujtaba in there and he didn't bring the Kubra in there. He brought the small one, not the big one. Okay. What's the strongest opinion? The strongest opinion is, you can't really say it's this one or that one. It's depending on what land, which one was most common. Some places in the world, the Sunan al-Kubra was very well read, and it was read, and it was the asal, and this is what the people would go to, and no one really looked at the Sughra. So, and of course, when they say Sunan, which one are they referring to? The Kubra. And some scholars, no one reads the Kubra, and everyone reads the what? Sughra. And so, this is the one that they're referring to. So, عدم القطع في المسألة. You can't clearly just say it's this one or this one, because the matter is أمر نسبي. It's such a subjective observation. It's subjective. It depends where you are in the world and how it's read. Okay? Today, if you look at it, the majority of places, or a lot of the places, I can't say majority because I didn't do Ihsa. But a lot of the times when you hear Sunan Nasa'i is being explained, it's meant which one? The small one. Like Al-Imam And the great scholar of our time, Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi, the Ethiopian Sheikh, the great noble Sheikh, who is ill right now, may Allah cure him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He explained Sunan al-Nisa'i. What did he do? He explained Sunan al-Nisa'i in 44 volumes. In 44, but it's only the small one. What is it? I don't know. 44 volumes, when I say it, is that two volumes is in one. So if you count it, it becomes 20, something like that. It becomes 22. Huh? But it's in one volume, there's about two volumes inside it. And he called it the Khiratul Uqba fi Sharhi Al-Mujtaba, something like that. The Khiratul Uqba, very good kitab. Question now is, how many books did I mention? The big one of Al-Imam Sunan-Nasa'i and what? Okay, the small one is the one that's called Al-Mujtaba. The small one is called what? Al-Mujtaba. The small one is called Al-Mujtaba. That's the name it has. Are we all together, brothers? What's the small one called? What did I just say Al-Mujtaba means? Selection. Are we all together, brothers? Selection. And it's to choose. Here the scholars asked, is the Mujtaba from Al-Imam al-Nasa'i or is it from his student Abu Bakr ibn Sunni? Why would they ask that question? The Kubra, everybody agrees that it's from Imam al-Nasa'i. The big one is Imam al-Nasa'i. But did Imam al-Nasa'i come and select a hadith from the big one and make a small one? Or his student did the selecting? Are we all together, brothers? Does that make sense? Am I making sense here? So they all agree the Kubra is by Imam al-Nasa'i, like in the Sughra, did Al-Imam al-Nasa'i go and take all of these ahadith out? Or did his student do this for him? There are two views regarding this issue. The first view is, the one who authored the Mujtaba is not Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. No, it's not. It's Abu Bakr ibn Sunni, his student. He's the one who did this. And he's one of the narrators of Al-Imam al-Nasa'i's Sunan al-Kubra. He narrated the Sunan from him. Are we all together? And he did the picking and the choosing. This is what they said. Who pushed that view? This view is pushed by Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, Tajuddin al-Subki. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, who died the year 748. Tajuddin al-Subki, who died the year 771. Ibn Nasir al-Din al-Dimashqi, who died the year 841. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, who said, وَالَّذِي وَقَعَ لَنَا مِن سُنَنُهُ هُوَ الْكِتَابُ الْمُجْتَمَى مِنْ انْتِخَابِ أَبِي بَكْرِ بْنُ السُنِّي. He says that in Isir Alam al-Nubala, that it's from Abu Bakr ibn Sunni. Rather, Ibn al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, refuted Ibn Athir, who's on the other side. Ibn Athir, what did he say? He's of the other view. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi refuted him and he said, هذا لم يصح. That's not true. Ibn Athir, Al-Jazari, you're wrong. Hey, what is it? بل المجتبى. The Mujtaba is what? اختيار ابن السني. It's actually the selection of Abu Bakr ibn Sunni. He's the one who did this, not Nasa'i. The second group of scholars, they say, no, Nasa'i himself wrote this book. Are we all together? The second group of scholars, what are they saying? Who wrote it? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i wrote it. Brothers, you guys may find these information irrelevant, maybe, sah? Don't. This is vital information. This is your source of legislation. You can't run somewhere and say, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i narrated this hadith and you don't even know the book. And you don't have no knowledge of it. And then somebody questioned, are we all together, brothers? And doubt is open. These are information you need to have with you. Especially the increase and the growing of the Orientalist and the doubts that are open on our source. Are we all together? It's important to every rock to lift it and say, what's under here? Does that make sense, brothers? And look at every information. It will be so beneficial for you to learn it. Wallahi, I'm leaving off a lot of information because I read a lot of books before I come to a class. I read 2 or 3 books. The point is, this information is vital, brothers. It's very necessary that you know it. So the second group of scholars, they said, the Mujtaba is written by Imam al-Nasa'i. He's the one who selected it. But within the second group, they broke him into 2 groups. The ones who said it was written by Imam al-Nasa'i, they amongst themselves, they broke into 2. Am I making sense? Yeah? So the first group of scholars, what did they say? The Mujtaba is written by who? Abu Bakr ibn Sunni. And the second group of scholars are saying is from whose works? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i himself. They broke into how many? 2. They broke into 2. The first one, A. And then the majority, they said, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, he took it from his Kubra, the big one. So the second party, they all agree, Nasa'i is the one who wrote the Mujtaba. Okay, yes, we all agree. But they're differing, where did he take it from? They're differing where? Where did he take it from? Some are saying, he took it from the Sunan al-Kubra. He read the Sunan al-Kubra. And they mention a story that Ibn Khayr al-Ishbiri, he has a fihrasat. Ibn Khayr al-Ishbiri has a fihrasat. I advise you to buy this book. He mentions that in all of his narrations for books and riwayat and the marruyat that he has and his tabat. Anyways, he mentions a chain from himself. He said, up to Abu Ali al-Ghassani, that al-Imam al-Nasa'i, rahimahullah, al-Imam al-Nasa'i in his Mujtaba, when he wrote his Kubra, the big one, Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, when he wrote his Kubra, he was questioned, he was asked, أَكُلُّهُ صَحِيح? Is everything in there sahih? His Kubra, the big one that he wrote. Is it all authentic? Al-Imam al-Nasa'i said, no. No, it's not all authentic. And then they said to him, فَكْتُبْ لَنَا, choose. Am I right for us? الصحيح منه, the authentic ones from the Kubra. Take it out, مُجَرَّدًا. Put it aside for us. Are we all together, brothers? Does that make sense? This is the Kubra. Take all the authentic ones that you believe are authentic and write it. Are we all together, brothers? So what did he do? فَصَدَعَ الْمُجْتَبَى. He authored the Mujtaba. Are we all together, brothers? So they said, this is Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, and where he got it from is the Kubra. That's the first group. This is the overwhelming majority. Jumhur believe this. Are we all together? And if you go to the Jam' al-Usul by Ibn Athir, he explains there, and he brings the story, and he talks about it there. The second group of those who say Al-Imam al-Nasa'i was the one who wrote it, they say it's not from the Kubra. He never took it from the Kubra. And where did he take it from? It's a riwayatun min riwayati Ibn Sunni. It's a narration from the narrations that Ibn Sunni narrated from Al-Imam al-Nasa'i. You see, one book has different riwayat, right? صح. Can it not? One book can have many riwayat. This is just one of the riwayat, one of the narrations from that book. It's actually not taken from the... It's not taken from there. And their argument is, and it's the strongest in my opinion, is that there are chapters within the Mujtaba that are not even in the Kubra. Actually new chapters. And if a scholar is summarizing, what would happen normally? Like Kitabul Imani wa Sunani. Not Kitabul Iman wa Shara'itihi. The Iman and its conditions. You find it in the Mujtaba, you will not find it in the Kubra. Are we all together? And there are books within the Kubra that are not in the Sughra, and or not in the Mujtaba, like Kitab al-Nu'ut and Kitab al-Amal al-Yawmi wal-Layla, and that's not in the Sughra or the Mujtaba. It's in the Kubra. So from this, the view that seems to be strongest is that it's a riwayatun min riwayat ibn sunni. Ama it's a riwayatun min riwayat sunni al-Nisa'i. It's one of the narrations of Sunan al-Nisa'i that's narrated from al-Imam Abi Dawud. Sorry, al-Imam al-Nisa'i. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. As for the discussion and bringing the evidence of both parties and cross-checking them, we won't be able to do that. And I will conclude there. Before I conclude, what I think I should mention is, what I think we should mention is the shuruh, the explanations that are put on this book. First of all, as I mentioned before, I'm of the opinion that students should buy Darul Ta'seel for all of the six books. Are we all together? Which one? Darul Ta'seel. Buy Darul Ta'seel. I'm for that. Okay. What about the explanations that are put on this book? And the first one is Zahrul Ruba Al Mujtaba. And it's done by Al-Imam Jalaluddin Al-Suyuti. It's actually a small explanation, it's nothing big. All he did was explain a couple of words here and there. Okay? And he didn't even speak about the chain of narrations, and it was published many times. One of the explanations that are also good to buy is At-Ta'liqat Al-Salafiyya Ala Sunani Al-Nasa'i, written by the great scholar from Shibhatul Qarratul Hindiya, from the subcontinent. His name is Al-Allama Abu Tib Ata'ullahi Al-Hanif. Ata'ullahi Al-Hanif. He wrote, his one is good. It's called Ta'liqat Al-Salafiyya Ala Sunan Al-Nasa'i. It's very good. It's very good to buy. Also, the best one so far, it seems to be the best, is Dakhiratul Uqba fi Sharh al-Mujtaba, and it's written by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ali Adam al-Ethiopi al-Walawi. Dakhiratul Uqba, it's called Dakhiratul Uqba fi Shuruh al-Mujtaba. And Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adam al-Ethiopi, what he does is, if you buy his books, like for example, he has Sharh on Sunan Nasa'i, he has also a Sharh on Sahih Muslim, has a sharah on it. It has a qita, a portion of explanation on Ibn Majah, which he didn't finish. I don't know if he finished now. He also has a sharah on Tirmidhi, which he finished, right? Dar Ibn al-Jawzi published. I think he finished it. He went out for the six books. And he's an imam in every field of the deen, imam. Arabiya, Balagha, Sarf, Nahu, Hadith, Fiqh. He's an Imam, Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi. Hafidhahullahu ta'ala wa ra'ah. And his kitab, what it does for you is he brings a lot of shuruh in there. Because he reads a lot, he'll bring you a lot of shuruh, a lot of explanations. Huh? My Sheikh, Dr. Ahmed Imam from Somalia, when I was in Somalia, I was reading on him Sharh Ilali Tirmidhi. In Somalia, I was reading on him Sharh Ilali Tirmidhi. And I asked him about the Sharh of Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi. And him and Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi are very close friends. Walidhalika, Sheikh Muhammad Ali, when he was writing his Sahih Muslim, he sent a copy to him and he said, "Can you look at it for me, Dr. Ahmed Imam?" And Dr. Ahmed Imam is a graduate from the University of Jamiat Ummul Qura, PhD. So when I was reading on him, Ilal al-Tirmidhi, Sharh Ilal al-Tirmidhi by Ibn Rajab, I said to him, you know, Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adil al-Thufi, you were very close to him, how is he like and whatnot? And also, his explanations of these books of hadith, he said to me, his explanations of course are profound, that is clear. But he said, when he was starting his Sahih Muslim, he said, I told him to use the best taba'ah, the best publication present for the hadith. In other words, make sure you buy a nuskha nafisa, a copy that's good. So when you explain it, you what? You're explaining a copy that's good. And Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adam Ethiopi, from that angle, he doesn't choose the best copies for the kitab, the asl kitab. Are we all together, brothers? It's because after him, Daru Ta'sil came. Daru Ta'sil, when did it come? Daru Ta'sil, after him, they brought Sahih Muslim. So when you look at his copy and you look at Daru Ta'sil, you tend to find wordings that are what? Different. Because Daru Ta'sil is more accurate. Are you with me, brothers? So Dr. Ahmed Imam said to me, if only he did tahqiq of the kitab first and then went to what? The sharah of the book, it would have been superb. And this truly reminds me of something, which is there's nothing that's perfect except the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. There's not a book on the face of this earth that you're going to find that you can say about it, لَا يَأْتِيهِ الْبَاطِلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ, that falsehood cannot come to it from the front or the back. There's no book that's complete. Every book has what? I mean, Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, if you read his silsila hadith al-sahiha and his silsila hadith al-da'if, you find a hadith that he made sahih, he put them in the weak again. Because he came back from that opinion, that it was authentic. And some of the students of the Shaykh, what they did was they compiled the taraju'at. Shaykh al-Albani, the hadith that he came back from, that he deemed that he was wrong on. Why did he deem it was wrong? Because new books were being published. So he was finding extra chains of narrations that he didn't have before. وَالْإِحَاطَةُ لِلَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى. And to encompass knowledge of everything, only is for Allah Azza wa Jalla. Who is it for? Allah Azza wa Jalla. وَلِذَلِكَ, the more you study, brothers, and the more you read, and the more you look at things, every single day what becomes clear to you is your ignorance. You're like, I was talking and I didn't even know this. Are we all together, brothers? Your ignorance becomes very apparent to you. Those are the explanations of those books. And there's much more, inshallah ta'ala, that one can look at from this great imam, his biography and his sunan. Any questions, inshallah? Huh? So exactly, this is a very common question that people ask, which is, this book has been already explained. And then another imam comes and explains it again. And then another imam comes and explains it. And another imam comes and explains it. And what benefit can this... How many tafsir of the Qur'an do we have? You with me? So wasn't Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's one not enough? Was Ibn Abi Hatim's one not enough? Did Ibn Kathir have to really write tafsir? Did Al-Imam Al-Alusi have to write a tafsir? Did Ibn Atiyah have to write a tafsir? Are you with me, brothers? Did these scholars have to come and write tafsir books? Yes. La shaka. Why? This actually shows us the gems in this religion doesn't end. Just gems. That it's so deep that to mention it, one person cannot do it by himself. So everybody, when he pushes deep, another one's going to go deeper. Also, some of these ahadith, they need current applications. I'll give an example. You have the kitab Bulughul Maram. One of the best explanations of Bulughul Maram today is the Minhatul Alam. Minhatul Alam by Sheikh Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan. One of the best. What is it called? Minhatul Alam. I think it's 10 volumes, taqriban. Dar ibn al-Jawzi published it. There's some mistakes in the copy, if you look at it, but like in the kitab, is amazing. And the mistakes I'm talking about is akhta' matba'i, not something with the author. When it got published, some mistakes, the publishing house, they did a couple of mistakes. Like in this is one of the best, if not the best in my opinion. One of the best explanations is Subul al-Salam by Amir al-San'ani. The point here is, you have the sharah of Abdullah Bassam. Are we all together? Who is the student of who? AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'di. The miza, the unique thing that you find from this one and you don't find from this one is, like for example, Abdullah Bassam's sharah of Bulugh al-Maram, he brings for you the current issues that the Muslims are facing, like the ruling of IVF. You guys, you all know what IVF is, right? What's the ruling in the Sharia regarding that? It's a current issue. The hadith is there. Hadith of Jabir is there. كُنَّا نَعْزِلُ وَالْقُرْآنُ يَنْزِلُ. We used to do quotas interruption whilst the Qur'an would come down. And here this hadith requires a current application. So some of the scholars, what they would do is they would take that hadith and they would give it an explanation of this time that you live in. So his kitab, the miza for it is, it gives you the majam' al-fiqhiyah, the rulings and the positions that they've taken. Like he'll say, Azhar, this is the qarar, this is the decision Azhar reached in this fiqh issue. Hey, tikibar al-ulama, this is what they said. Rabidat alim al-islam, he said this. Which you would have to go out of your way to research, it's already there for you. Are we all together about this? So what I mean by this is that each kitab, when you read it, it will tackle issues from different angles. It's like the concept of, if somebody doesn't understand that cup is half full, he may understand that cup is half empty. People understand things in different ways. You may like this sharah and it suffices you and it gives you all you want and you probably took so much out of it. But another person, this one may not do it for him, this one may do it for him. Another reason why scholars would keep writing an explanation is the standard of language weakens over time. Imam al-Nawawi's Arabic was the formal, strong Arabic. Lakin when you come to today's standard, people are using a more simpler, easier Arabic. Are we all together, brothers? Like for example, when you read the tafsir of who? AbdulRahman Nasir al-Sa'di, it's like you're drinking water. So easy. So easy. If you read Ibn Uthaymeen's tafsir of the Quran, it's so easy. It's like you're drinking water. It's nothing complicated. But when you go to the tafsir of the Ibn Kathir and you go to Alusi and others, they bring technical terms. Al-ibrata bi'umum al-lafzi la bi-khusus al-sabab. They speak technical. He will not. So the standard of the language is different. Does that make sense? That's the reason why it's scholars are all coming together and they do that. And another thing, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti said when he wrote his tafsir book, his Adwa' al-Bayan, he said that this tafsir, writing it, it's a reality of the principle of the scholars, which is وَكَمْ تَرَكَ الْأَوَّلُ لِلْآخَرِ. How much have the early generation left for the late generation? I mean, they left a lot of things for us that we can still explain and we can still talk about. Huh? And that the chapter of ijtihad, independent reasoning, is not closed. Ibn Salah, he said ijtihad is closed. Amir al-Sal'ani wrote a kitab that ijtihad is not closed. Are we all together, brothers? No. Okay, remember Imam al-Nasa'i, when he writes a book, the question is, what do I mean by that the Mujtaba is a narration from the narrations of the Sunan? What does that actually mean? What it means is that the Sunan, a lot of the students heard from Imam al-Nasa'i, isn't that the case? No, more than one person narrated the book from him. If I author a book today, somebody may read the book and say, give me an ijaz on the book. Am I they narrate it from me? AbdulRahman read the whole book on me. So then somebody narrates it from him. You may have narrated the book from me, and then another person narrated it from me, and another person narrated it from me, another, and your copies are all different. Why? You narrated it from me the early stages of my book. This person narrated from me when it fully developed. Another person narrated from him, when I tried to take out some narrations. Does that make sense? So it's just a narration from those narrations that are out there, and it's not a new book. It's a narration from the Sunan al-Kubra. It's one of the narrations. That's what it is. Inshallah, let's start the fiqh, inshallah ta'ala, the second. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.